John stuff. John wrote the Gospel of John. He wrote the three epistles. He wrote the Book of Revelation. The Book of Revelation is not included in Johannine literature. It's usually a separate book. It's not really done with Johannine literature, so we will not be dealing with the Book of Revelation. Lucky to be the second chapter of the Gospel of John. We will, Lord willing, study the Gospel of John, 1 John, 2 John, 3 John. However, for those of you who know my teaching style, those of you who don't, I will give you a little clue. It is my desire in life, in my relationship with the Lord, to learn to search the scriptures in such a way that I can savor every morsel, every little bit. In other words, take a small bite and to enjoy the flavor of that, to get as much out of that one bite. You don't know if you're going to live tomorrow, you know, and to enjoy that to as much as you can. That's a good philosophy of life. But I do it with the scriptures too, and what it's brought to me is a great enjoyment of the scriptures, I think greater than most people. I'm not saying I'm greater than most people, I'm just saying that I think that I maybe enjoy the scriptures a lot more than a lot of people because of my style, or whatever you want to call it, because of my approach. That if I was stuck on an island with John 1:1, I wouldn't go, oh my God, what am I going to do? I can read that in, 30 seconds. I would go, whoa, the revelation that I'm going to get out of these scriptures, these words, is going to be tremendous. And I am going to wait, I'm going to look, I'm going to meditate on each word in light of different angles, however I can, whatever I come up with, and see the Lord in these scriptures. And what I've found by doing that is that I remember there was a couple of years where I studied, just studied John, the Gospel of John. In fact, I really didn't get out of the second chapter, I don't think, in my study. And what the Lord showed me in John, let me tell you, I was going through this kind of a hard time at the same time because people were reading all these other books and covering all this material in the Bible, studying all this stuff. And I thought, man, everybody's getting ahead of me. Anybody ever felt like that? Everybody's getting ahead of it. And I don't know that we necessarily have to be ahead, but we don't want to be behind. That's kind of a general approach to most of us, that we just don't want to be behind. And I had this feeling that I was getting behind, but I knew I was obeying the Lord by approaching the scriptures the way I was approaching. But there's still that feeling that people were studying whole books and I was in the book of Hebrews. People come up and say, last 2 months I've been studying Hebrews, what chapter? Chapter 13 now, I've gotten so much out of it. They say, what verse are you on? Or what word are you on? And then the Lord showed me something. He showed me that the things that I was getting out of these scriptures were like studying whole books in other places. I don't know how to tell you this, but the best way I can describe it is that you can study an arm and a hand and all this stuff, or you can study a cell, and everything is made up of cells. If you broke you down to, or if everything here is broken down to atoms, and all things other basic thing. All colors are understood by the three basic colors from which they came. You know, all music comes from just a certain amount of the alphabet. It's just 26 letters. You know what I mean? There's a basic thing that from which you can understand all of them. And I began to realize that the Lord was teaching me the basic patterns of everything so that everything could begin to make sense and I could learn everything from the root or from the foundation. And so I've learned that if we don't cover all the material, it's really not necessarily that bad, because much of what you'll be receiving will be information that will cover all of it. Once again, it's my desire to cover it all, but you know, we do have to do good. We're just becoming a balance, so I don't think, let's get to it. You know, I mean, First John is a handful, you know. I mean, the wonders of First John is just amazing. So an added to trying to cover a lot of material is the fact that I have been going to the dentist a lot and will be going a lot, and it's going to play havoc with my schedule. And I hate that. I would rather you have good basic time to just sit down and get up and go play. But it looks like for this semester, I didn't have classes. Try to keep your ear open to if you didn't show up for this class, maybe you'll end up teaching some other day or something like that. So I realize that you, your life doesn't totally go around, but I'm just trying to say that it's going to be kind of hard. To begin with, I'm going to, I'm definitely going to go slow, because I have spent so much time in the Gospel. I'm going to go slow, and it may seem like you know, we're halfway through the semester and we're just getting out of the second chapter. We can cover a lot of material. But in last semester, I taught in terms of the Latin God, and I had 8 pages, and I went half of the second, I did 2 semesters actually, half of the second semester, I taught out 8 pages of my notes. When I got ready for John, I printed out John, the first chapter, 12 pages. Oh, brother, this is going to take a while. But, so we're going to take the slow, savory approach first. Okay? And I hope by teaching this way that it can teach you something about maybe possibly another approach, not necessarily the only approach, but another approach to searching the scriptures. Really evaluate. And I think that just John 1:1 is going to give us that net. We will study the word in. You know, it's going to end the beginning with the word words with God. We will study the word in. We will study the word be. We will study the word in. We will see it in. And we're going to take that word and put it in our mouth and let it slowly melt. Find out all the flavors that are in that. So don't be discouraged if we seem to be going slow at first. Just, you know, thank the Lord that like Jake and I'm driving gears. We're going rushing badly through because you'd be inundated with that. That's all that I really needed to say. Any questions? There are 4 Gospels, and what I'm fixing to share is a small portion of one day when I teach the 4 Gospels. I will really get into some things, but I'm going to give you a little piece that's in that study, just to help you to understand something. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, these are all Gospels, right? Okay, each one of them has a different approach. All right. Matthew, the the son of David, the son of Abraham. That's the part, that's Matthew 1:1. All right. What do we get from this, knowing John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word? What we know is the beginning for Matthew is Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. So Matthew starts back with David and Abraham to begin. His beginning is there. Now turn with me to Mark. Mark has his beginning. And his approach is based on his beginning. Mark 1:1 says, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets, behold, I send my messenger before my face. And he begins with a declaration of John the Baptist, that this thing started when John came. The beginning is, he says, the beginning of the gospel. God sent his messenger in John. And if you were living in that day, you'd go, well, before John, there hadn't been a prophet in 400 years, so this is, you know, okay? And then Luke's actually kind of tricky how it does its approach. Because he starts about the declarations of those things, for as much as we have taken in hand, set forth in order of declaration, those things which are most surely believed among us. So he does that. And he starts telling some of the story. But if you look over in chapter 3, verse 23, of Luke 3:23. Okay, and here we have a beginning. Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age, being, as supposed, the son of Joseph, who was the son of Noah. And then he starts his genealogy, and he's with Jesus as the son of Joseph, and he takes him all the way back to Adam. You trace out this genealogy, it goes all the way back to Adam, on verse 38, who was the son of Enoch, who was the son of Seth, who was the son of Adam, who was the son of God. Okay? So now, John, the Gospel of John. Every one of these have given you a beginning point. And like I said, when I teach four Gospels, I'll really get into all that right now. I'm just showing you something. This is how John starts his beginning. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. And the Word was God. He doesn't start with Adam. He doesn't start with Joseph before Adam. He doesn't start with Adam. He doesn't start with Abraham or David, Joseph, or John the Baptist. He says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. He starts even before our beginning. We'll get into that more clearly. At a certain juncture. Let me read a little bit. The birth of Jesus is not even mentioned in the Gospel of John. We realize that the Gospel doesn't start with the birth of Jesus, but with the beginning. With the beginning. And knowing the beginning is going to be all important as we get into this. Because everything that John writes is absolutely words unless you have it laid on. You won't understand. If you misapply it, you'll understand the surface. But you won't really get it unless you understand it again. Like I said, there's different forms of that. The gospel is the life we live, not just the words we speak. Meaning, you know, like Mark said, the beginning of the gospel. These words declare the gospel. But John says, the gospel which we preach has its beginning in the Word. The Word.
It's interesting, that passage in that book, and it says,
the Word was made flesh. God saw to it that the Word was made flesh. Theologians turned it back into words. It's supposed to be life. Life is what we receive. And what it's all about, and I don't care what word you know, what creed you've given yourself to. And most of us, once we become Christians, go about setting down our creed so that we can feel stable. And there is no stability in creeds. There's only stability in Him and love that He is and is to come. Everything else will eventually crumble. And everything we can be shook will be shook. And that, we have God's promise on that. So it's wise to find the beginning of God's season that was before this was stable. We call that stable. A little shaky can make that long now. We call this stable. It's all going to pass away. There's got to be a stability in us that when this shakes, we go, what did David say? It was so good. Though 10,000 fall beside me, yet I will trust the Lord. Though the earth be shaken and the mountains move, yet I will rejoice in my God. That's a great song, David. Do you believe that? You hear people sing stuff. You hear people say stuff. None of that really means anything. It only means something when the truth has gotten you. And when the truth has gotten you, then you're God. When you're getting the truth, and you're, I want to share this, I want to impress you, I want to, it's our responsibility to want to know the truth, the Lord. The truth, the Lord. Because He said, I'm the way, the truth. To know Him. Not just in His temporal relationships. Savior. Was He always Savior before there was a sinner? No. Healer. Was He always a healer before there was somebody that said, no. But what was He? He was something. Do we know the Lord? Do we know God? Start that one. We'll get into that later. And to me, it don't matter. Bible school or what church you're part of. God will dictate. Truth will dictate certain things. Oh, that's so common, because the truth will dictate certain things. You can, you can judge yourself or others in a certain sense, not in a negative sense, whether they know the truth, because the truth dictates a certain way, and the flesh dictates a certain way. It's just a law. It's just the way it is. You don't have to be judgmental. In fact, the best thing is to just accept the truth and not be judgmental. You know what I'm saying? And then you see clearly that you may help someone else get the word out there. So in the beginning was the Word. It doesn't begin with once upon a time or at the beginning. There must be a reason God didn't start Genesis 1:1 and John 1:1. With once upon a time, or a long, long time ago in the galaxy of our life. But it all begins, all. I want you to think of all. I mean, this is the beginning. Just put it all here. I'm not going to use words like this. I'm going to use words like all.
Just all the things of the scriptures.
would overwhelm you. You know, how will I know this in my lifetime? How can, you know, if I gave myself to studying every minute, how is it possible? Well, it's not if you go, if you approach it from awe. But you must understand from whence all comes, from where it comes. Okay? All things come out. And all things are by this one, for this one, and to this one. By him they consist. And they all have meaning when the one is understood. A lot of what I'm going to be saying to you today, and the next time it is, but particularly today, you've heard. And they'll, you know, we can call the same time or whatever. But until we hear this from the Lord, I don't care what we know. I'll probably say that much too. Because who could awaken a person's ear when they are fleshly, earthly, living here, they're just, you know, oops, you know, and they're living their life like this, and they're reading the scriptures based on that linear approach, and they love God, but I mean, you know, but who could awaken an ear to see beyond all of that and to see as John did? You know, the beginning wasn't here. The beginning goes back before our beginning. And to see it, not just hear about it, you know. I've used the example of somebody standing at an ocean and painting a beautiful picture of an ocean with the sun and seagulls and all this stuff. You take it home, you hang it on your wall. Somebody sitting there in your living room going, man, isn't that beautiful? You know, and you can truly say, you don't even know. I've seen the real. You know, you're just looking at my impression of the real. And even if I'm good, I ain't that good. You know, and there's a look or whatever, I don't know how to put it, in that person's eye, there's a feel about that person that when they say you fall. Yeah. Then you can go, you know, I mean, I know this. I know from being on the other end, going, wait a minute, I don't like that. I don't like that little look. It tells me that you've literally seen this, and this is blowing me away. This picture's blowing me away. But you saw the real, and your words aren't convincing me, but something has let me know that you're not staring at a still picture. Beautiful as it is. But you are yet seeing what you saw. This is what God did to Moses. Go up. See. Go down. Make it according to the pattern that I showed you. That's power. Because he didn't see that down. He saw that up. And up was down. We'll get into this. John says, you know, he that's from the beginning is preferred before me. But he's not before me, he's coming after me. You know, it sounds like a parable. But it's not a parable. You know, the one that's up is down, and the one that's before is after, but, you know, but he's making sense, but it's not sense to us. What? Why are you talking this way? Because he had seen it. And so, you know, and we'll talk about this, and we'll use words. We'll use words. That's all I can use. When I preach, I use words. So I paint pictures with words, but they're still just pictures. It doesn't mean anything. And if you've seen, let's say that every picture that I've ever painted, you've seen over the years. For some of you going back as far as, you know, years, and this room probably 6, 7, maybe 8 years. So you've seen a lot of my pictures. And there are certain elements, because it's my style, that has certain elements. We hear these elements in Christ. New man. Revelation. After a while, I just look at the picture. Never seen the radio. I would never condition myself. I would fight to not condition myself. Old ways of thinking and patterns. I would be real and say, I don't understand that word or the reality behind that word, and I want peace. I want to savor. I want to know more. I want to know more. Because he's the only one, the Holy Spirit's the only one who can open the eyes of our understanding. So I said it doesn't begin with once upon a time or at the beginning or a long time ago. It all begins with the word can. So far, we've really only discussed a few little words. Can. All. But you know, it doesn't begin with all. It begins with in. Now, you're immediately, your well-trained minds will immediately go to the truth. So, in Christ. Pulling that out of the computer that God has given, we call the brain. And knowing Randy's teaching, we'll say, yes, I know this truth. But I want to say right now, because I'm saying it from the Lord, that there are many of you who you know and you don't know. And even if you immediately go to areas of truth, you've only seen that you're making a reference to a painting. You are not. Because when these truths get you, they dictate direction and light and tones and colors and approaches. And they dictate color. It's like you're a glass of water. You meet the Lord, you take a blue dye and you pour it in there. It doesn't just sit in there. It blends into everything that the glass was before, and it's no longer just clear water. You see what I'm talking about? If you pour tea in there, it's no longer just clear water. It's now brown, but it's more than brown. It has another flavor to it. And this is the reality behind the word pictures. It's not, well, I know this truth, and I'm not a whole lot different for it. But I know what you're going to say before you say it. And I feel good about that, because before I used to hear you talk, and I didn't know the words, and I'd feel scared because it was unknown areas. But now I have some security in the terminology. I'm not scared. Well, I don't think there's anything to be afraid of. I mean, I think of words like anticipation, excitement. It go behind what is here, you know, the reality behind that, to somehow move behind that. You know, and really go, I don't know. I mean, Lord, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. I admit I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. And I don't know. Okay. I don't know. And he goes, he always knew I didn't know. But he goes, thanks for the extra emphasis. You seem like you're ready to know. But as long as your cup's full, you can't fill it. They all run out. Oh, I know. And anything that you know, and this is a reality, you may know more than I know. You may. There may be those that know more than I know. But for you, there's still more than I know. I mean, more. I mean, more. I know that for me there's more, and I'm actively pursuing that. One of the reasons why I'm teaching is because I want to know more. I know that sounds funny, but I'm teaching because I want to know more. It puts you in a position that if I walked up here and went, And the beginning was, you know, and no line, no Lord, you know it. You go, what have you been doing for the last few days? Shouldn't you have been preparing? You know, you ever get up and preach a sermon? You know, you want it to be the Lord. Well, the best way to be the Lord is never prepare a sermon. Just go after the Lord. Never prepare a sermon. Just go after the Lord. I'm with the Lord. And the Spirit of God will see to it, because He came to do one thing primarily: teach you Christ. That's it. You go, well, I've got a good relationship. I've got a good relationship with the Holy Spirit. How do you know? I'm learning Jesus. So, in the beginning, let's see, did I even get a reference to it? It all begins with the word in. It all begins with the word in. All is not before in. In is before all. It all begins with the word in. That's exciting. That's narrowed it down a bunch. You got all, now you got in. You know what I mean? I mean, narrow, that's a wonderful thing to begin to see. In is before all. There is that which we call the beginning and that which God calls the beginning. Matthew started with his beginning. The book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ. Back then. The son of Jesus Christ. The son of David. The son of David. Well, Matthew was Jewish. He starts with the Jewish nation. Abraham was the father of the Jews. Makes sense, doesn't it? You know? Mark starts with the whole thing. You know, I haven't been a prophet in 400 years, and the ball finally gets rolling. He starts with John the Baptist. Luke is a Gentile. He goes all the way back to Adam, says it all started back then. But John says, no, in all. Because if you go back to Adam, there's still a bunch out there. Part of the all. So you go back again. In the beginning. Why didn't it say at the beginning? In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. Share something with you. Some of you have heard this, so it just depends on where you're at to receive it again, or to really truly receive it. Turn with me to Matthew chapter 13. Some of you have never heard this, and it can be significant. It was significant to me. It was very significant to me. It was so significant that I truly believe the significance is yet, like that dye you poured into the water, it's yet coloring my life. I really believe that. So these aren't scriptures. This isn't something I heard a preacher say once and remembered to be used at a later time. This is something that has touched my life. I'll never forget the day I saw it. Matthew 13, verse 1. The same day when Jesus went out of the house and sat by the seaside, a great multitude were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a boat and sat. And the whole multitude stood on the shore, and he spoke many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. So we understand that this is going to have to do with growth, fruitfulness, life. Okay? I mean, if you can automatically can already start thinking in terms of what does this refer to. And when he sowed, some of the seeds fell. And if you want to do this, you got a pen, mark the word by the wayside. Just the word by, to be one. By the wayside. And the fowls came and devoured it. What do the fowls represent? Demons. Jesus said that. Keep reading chapter 13 and you'll get his explanation. Okay. Verse 5. Some fell, circle or underline the next word, upon. Some fell upon. See it there in verse 5. Some fell upon. Underline the word upon. Stony places. Where they had not much earth. Forthwith they sprang up. because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched because they had no root. They withered away. Verse 7. And some fell among, underline the word among. Among thorns. Among thorns. And the thorns sprang up and choked them. Verse 8, but other seed fell into good ground and brought forth fruit. Some 100, some 60, some 30. He who hath ears to hear, let him hear. Is that a good little saying for Jesus to throw in there at the last of that? There are different relations, how we relate to the Lord. These help us to understand how we are related. Some are by the Lord. Some are among. Some are upon. But the word in is where the good ground is found. In is related to good ground. In is a good, fertile beginning. Understand what I just said? In is a good, fertile beginning. In leads to good ground and good growth. Okay? And good what? You know what I mean? You can just keep going. I mean, just good. Good ground, good growth, good fruit, good plants, good. You see what I'm saying? We're starting to move it all. If you get that seed in there, good color, good smell, good fruit, you know what I mean? You're getting it all. You're getting all because it got in. Getting all because it got in, and if you don't get it in, you can work for all, but you'll never get all because you can't contain all except for in. Okay, in. Have a part of it. This truth is so powerful that I don't want to leave it in. In. Okay? In. To be in. We are in the body of Christ. There's no need to talk about the new man. Let's do this. Let's do this properly. New man. Ever seen that terminology before? Oh, how significant. Oh, how great. There is new. There is man. There is new man. There's all that relates to new. There's all that relates to man. All that relates to resurrection, all that relates to the life of this one that we are in. Wonderful. Wonderful. Beyond wonderful. I mean, beyond, honestly, beyond wonderful. We talk much about it. This truth means absolutely nothing without him. It means nothing. If you're not in the new man, then no, I don't care what you know about new. I don't care what you know about man. Do you understand what I'm saying? I mean, if you were just with the new man, or by the new man, or among the new man, you know, we're in the body. You know, there's a lot of people that gather with the body. With the body. There's different words you can use. But the truth dictates your existence. You don't work the truth. You don't work the truth. The truth dictates your existence. I found this out years ago, contrary to whole lot of my plans and ideas, the truth had to dictate certain things. I'm going to give you an example of this on top of mine. Just came. I was a missionary in Jamaica. Doing fine. You know, my wife and I were ministering, but Jamaica went communist at the time, and they wouldn't renew our visas, so we had to come back. We're going, you know, the body that had sent us had disseminated, reformed, and got a new name and moved to Missouri. fragments of the body that sent us was this ranch out here in Decatur, Texas area that was run by a guy that drove me bananas. I couldn't get along with his personality about that. And so I was going to come, you know, well, what are we going to do? We're leaving. We have to leave the mission field. We're not leaving the same time everybody else. Our visa came up right now. We're leaving. My wife and I. What am I going to do? You know, my whole life, you know, I got a plane. That was that me? Where is it taking me? What is I'm going to do? Well, you know, I can get a job, give me a house, you know, or I can, you know, look for, I can get a skill, or, you know what I mean? I can get an education. You know, I mean, I can rob a store. I mean, I've got all kinds of choices here. But I knew that I was in. I was in. I wasn't with them, by them. I was in. And so I had two choices. Part of the fragmentary group moved to Missouri, and the other part was this place I did not want to go as far as Randy's personality, the way I mixed with that portion of the fragments left of the end that I was in. You understand kind of what I'm saying? So I got back, because my plane landed me in Dallas, which I was told, my wife's pregnant. Go have the baby then come join us in Missouri. So, you know, that meant for a couple of months I had to get a job, whatever, and then we were going to join them up there. Well, while we were there, in the little short interim, the place in Missouri closed down. You knew that the theme was you, but that just left one option, and it just went, oh. No, 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 no. And so I'm just going, oh, you know, and I knew the truth was going to win out, but you know, sometimes I just go, oh, God, I don't want to be there. Anywhere but here. But then I can go, ah, okay, what do you want? Yeah, I'm going to go now. You know, because the truth, you are in the truth, the truth has you, and the truth will keep you in. It does. It does. And I'll tell you why. Because the new man is the greatest truth. And if the greater truth, which is spiritual, first and foremost spiritual, and spiritual on the inside of your spirit, folks, if your spirit will dictate your body. Hello? Your spirit will, or your spirit won't control your body. You'll control your body. I'll control my body. But I am not Lord. And how do we make Jesus Lord, folks? How do we make Jesus Lord? By the way he is and what he wants to do and what he says is the truth. You know what I mean? Against sometimes, it will, you know, I mean, you know, it's kind of a running joke. We have, you know, several people here that go, you know, I ain't in Texas. Well, but you're here. Why? He wasn't Texas. But it was a spiritual truth that has you here. And if Texas is the worst place on the planet, God says go to Texas. And you'll be. But, now, here's the deal. Let's talk about it. Is the word the reality? Is the reality in the primary reason? Let me tell you why. Because, do you know that you can be at and the truth still be motivating, but it's not got you? In other words, let's do this. Okay, let's. Oh, that I were a true artiste. Let me try something weird here that, who knows how much it's going to work. And we'll put we've got a circle here. Okay, see this? The circle is actually the new man. Okay. Oh, the new man. Jesus, the new man. Jesus. Oh, I want to be by. Remember the word there? By. Anybody remember the word? Bounds in the air like the word by. Check it out. Am I lying to you? You read the scripture. Check it out. Now, if I'm lying to you, then walk out of here and don't ever come back. Or just read the scripture. Fowls of the air like by. They might even say, oh, go ahead and snuggle up as close as you can get. Don't ever get in. Just get by. Well, how about among? We can get right in here. I'm right in among, you know. You know that we say we're in the body of Christ, but the body of Christ only gathers. That may not do much to you, that doesn't fix, but to me it's a lot to spend more here. In dictates gatherings. Not gathering does not constitute the truth. In the beginning, right? You know that, but in dictates among, if I'm to be among. Now we're just talking out. But in dictates that. Among does not, because among is what? Thorns. And get you and choke what you do to that. I'm trying to think of a way to do this. I've got a flower bed at home, and it's got these rails that keep the flowers on this side and the grass and the weeds on this side. Dog my cat, that there ain't a little opening just like this between the rails and this music on this side. You know what I mean? And they're going right through that crack. It's not very big, but they're right through that crack and they're choking my flowers. How interesting. Gee, Revelation, I could just read this. Now, you know, we can hear these trees go, oh, amen, and walk out and be among. Or be by. Or, you know, upon or whatever. With. But in must dictate. And in is not a outward truth. It is an inward truth. Dictates out. It is not an outward truth. Let me explain. Somebody can say, well, that means that, you know, you have to be in the body of Christ. That means you have to be da-da-da-da. Somebody take that as face value and just say, okay, because he taught in as opposed to by or among, that I'm going to do this. That is not accepting the truth of in. That is accepting my teaching and the manifestation of in. But that's not accepting the truth. Because a person that accepts that says, okay, I'm in. If you're not really in spirit, if you're not really in spirit, you're just a bum. It brings havoc. And the bad thing is, you know, usually, you don't notice it as much as somebody else does. Most of them know what I'm talking about. But the word in, you look at these bricks right here, and this brick is in there. It's in there. Well, it's not just an independent in there. It's bringing strength to everything around it, which it's all tied together. Because it's in the body, it's in the body, it's in the body of Christ. That's why it says, you are in the body of Christ. Okay, you're in the body, you're in it, you're not with it. The body of Christ is not what shows up on Sunday morning, that's with it, or among it. Well then, what is the body of Christ? Well, this new man is the body of Christ. This new man is what the body of Christ is. Is this here? And his works in each one, and that makes up the new man outward.
This is like, very, not very much talking about, but so, Charles and I were talking about this the other day, and I realized this is a very initial, very little, but we were talking about being plugged in.
See, I thought about that word today too, plug in. We use, that's not biblical, plug in. We never say plug at the wall.
Yeah. We're talking about being plugged into the mind of the Lord and place you in. And how that there are people in bodies that are not, you can tell that they're not plugged in because their minds are not plugged into what's going on. They tend to have a separate mind.
But see, that still is an outward manifestation.
Right. And there tends, but because it's real deceitful, because the outward manifestation seems to appear to be part of something.
Right.
And it seems like, good old Joe, he jumps right in there.
Very good.
But you find at times there are little things. This is what I've seen, is that they may do the whole swing of things, but there are little areas that seem to be missed. And you start to learn that, they're not playing with the mind of what's going on. It just seems to be that way.
Well, you saying that earlier, you showed me that little picture. But have you ever seen one of these stone polishers? You may know what it is, a little canister you put one of the stones in, you turn it like this. What does it do? Well, at first it starts hitting and swimming, and all the sharp edges are hitting up against one another, and it smooths them out, doesn't it? Yeah. Okay. Well, let me, the way I kind of saw this, but I'm just going to give it the way I just saw the picture. Instead of like that, I'm going to put this block right here, gosh, it still isn't going to be exactly where I had left. I'm going to do it like this. It's like this craggy rock right here. Okay. And this craggy rock right here. And this craggy rock right here. And this one right here. Now let's put them all together. You know what we got? A bomb. Normally, we got a bomb.
Yeah.
Now what I pictured when you were saying that is somehow, now I'm just giving you my picture, but there's like this bit deals on a pivot with a steel rod on the backside that turns this thing. So this pivot goes like this. Okay? And they're all are on this pivot, they're all turning up. Okay? Get in the picture?
Right.
I mean, it's the same principle as the thing, but the Lord's, I'm trying to go with what I just saw. And so what's happening? Bim, 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 man. And you know what we call that? We call that training. Okay? We call that training. Training is what it's all about. This is working towards us. The goal is to get this sharp point off of me right there. The goal is to clear this thing, that rough edge off. No, it's not. That is not the goal. And if you've been getting some of that, good, but that ain't it. That ain't it. Training ain't it. Training is a small part of this whole thing. That ain't it. Training is a must. All right, but here's what I saw. Is that this thing, so boom, boom, man, the training's happening, all this stuff. And of course, the result of true training isn't just hitting up against somebody. There is this relationship he has to have with the Lord that helps him to, if hard times made you a son of God, then everybody in India would be the most spiritual people in the world. Because they got a heart of wisdom. Right? And in hard times, it's your relationship with God in the hard times that makes something happen, okay? So don't ever forget that either. Okay, but I saw this boom, man, all this is hitting. Okay, and you know, it's like all of a sudden I started seeing a transition taking place where this baby was conforming to what God had in mind. That's why this looks contrary to everything I was saying before. But to what God had in mind, it's becoming symmetrical with this one who is becoming symmetrical, with this one who is becoming symmetrical, with this one who is becoming symmetrical.
Straighter. It's really symmetrical, and that's my plea.
Okay? And because now we're talking about this goal, which isn't training, but is the new man. Okay. Now, from this, if this be true, what is heaven going to be like? Well, we Americans already know. Everybody gets a mansion, you get sent off in 8 billion directions, and you pretty much have your own little party, and you go to the temple every once in a while and check on the Lord. Ephesians out. Throw Colossians out. For sure those two. I tell you, that we're being made as a habitation of God, and that habitation is more akin to it. Because he describes, the word describes it as a building that is fitly joined together. That is in. That block is in. That block is in. It ain't get trained, so you can go out over here, and everybody go out and say, I don't need all this hip anymore, I got all my edges straight. You know what I mean? Now I'm a nice, clean. Do you understand what I'm saying? It isn't that. It couldn't be that. It can't be. Jesus left, came down here, and he bore all that to join you to him, not so you could just get your act cleaned up, but so he can build something. The end goal isn't salvation. It is a temple in the Lord that we might be a habitation through his spirit in the whole. It is, how do I say this? New man, that means, what does that mean? Does it mean what God means? In. Does it mean what God means? There is no beginning. We're going to see this. There is no beginning without in. You can't even begin. There is no beginning. There is no beginning without in.
Huh? Yes. That relates to what you taught a little bit towards the last eternal plan of God through, by, unto.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. But this is even stronger in the area of by and among and these truths here, but yeah. But this thing is so powerful because God said to Moses, okay, see this pattern, go down and make it according to that. Moses. God's saying that to you and me. He didn't say, see some spiritual truth up here and then whatever you live will be contrary to it. It couldn't be. The word in the beginning, and I will show you this, but in the beginning will dictate from now on in the Gospel of John. You can't lose it. It will be the foundation. It will be. It will be the foundation. Because, you know, this God indwells this. And so I'm picturing, you know, misunderstandings about the new man that is, even us. You know, it just occurs to me that even us, our vision, even our vision for this place. Let's go back to this right here. Talking about this place in relationship to all the... Okay, so what is the vision? What is the purpose here? What is the purpose? Well, the purpose is training. Let's train everybody, make them all wholesome. And then bring in the less wholesome to make them wholesome and send out the more wholesome who don't need I'm a finger, don't need a palm, which doesn't need an arm, which doesn't need, he ain't cutting up pieces and laying them all out and throwing them in different directions and saying, okay, the goal really was to just kind of make sure that you know you're a finger and you function like one. The goal is in, and if you don't like the truth in, or somebody watching this video doesn't like the truth in, run! Because the truth is going to get you. And not only that, but I believe this is the truth we'll be living through all eternity. You're not. You don't. Well, I say, I'm going to jump ahead. Because we all want to leave at the beginning. But I'm going to show you that you don't leave the beginning. You don't. Because if you do, then you're lost. The beginning is your compass. In. And you're not with the beginning. You're in. And so God is, now think about this. We say, well, God is sending out. These last days, God's going to be sending out. But what does he send out? Groups and teams, it's like organs more than it is individuals. We never believed in the individual missionary. We say, let's send a team, let's send a body. We believe that. So it can't. This thing isn't tearing apart. It is, in a certain sense, it's growing together. He is gathering together, and then what? Knitting. Gathering, and then he's knitting with the gatherers. What's the end time about? Gathering in all the harvest. Bringing it all together. What is everything you read in the book of Ephesians on the new man? It all comes together in one. See? And so, now that begins to control the outward. That is not the outward. That is not the outward. We're not talking outward here. We're talking in, blowing you away. The reality of in the beginning getting so much of you that you find yourself drawn toward. And do you understand what I'm saying? You find yourself. You can't help it. You find yourself because the truth has you, and there you are. And like we said, down Texas and everything, you know what I mean? And, I was laughing at people even on that or any level because I go, well, just, when God sends me to Costa Rica, you're still going to be in Texas because you keep, I hate blondes. Well, get ready. I was going to send blondes all around. You know what I mean? Well, I hate, I hate asparagus, so we're going to get 800 tons of asparagus soup in mission. You know what I mean? I mean, the best thing to do, but see, even if that were training not to complain about asparagus, that ain't what it's all about. Well, I've learned, I lived in that mission, and I learned to be content with asparagus because God will send you a bunch of asparagus soup, and I learned to live with a faulty shower thing if you have to and still love God and everything. So now I'm mature. So Steve said, now I'm in on God. Give me a big mansion. You know what I mean? I'm going to just do my own thing because I've learned that ain't even it. Oh, God, thank you for bringing that out. That is so good. That is wonderful because that ain't it. This is it. This is, you learn so you can get in there. You know what I'm saying? We need to quit. I'm past time. But I think it really, really, I'm not just talking. This isn't just a good actor. I'd like to be a good preacher. This truth is so precious. I just want to say that. It is so precious. And it's bigger than all. And we know from here how big all. life, your direction, your fullness, your plans, your goal, you, what you will see brought to pass. We say, yes, bring us into vigor, into the body. Plug in to what your spirit says. He didn't happen here, as you said, Jesus, right here. We desire to hear so. If we don't hear at this moment, open our ears that we're vain here. That is us. We are willing to lay down false concepts, lies, deceptions, plans, anything else that is contrary to your truth, so that you